Hello, in this video I'm going to be looking at valence bond theory, just some practice problems. So I'm assuming that you've already looked at how valence bond theory works and how hybridization works of orbitals when you mix orbitals together, like an S and a couple of P orbitals, that sort of thing, to form those hybridized orbitals. So this is just for practice at determining. So we're going to look at several molecules and look at identifying the hybridization. You can do this at any atom, really, in a molecule that has some hybridization going on. And we'll also identify, at least in the first structure, how many sigma and how many pi bonds. So again, if you haven't learned about hybridization, sigma and pi bonding, you need to go back and look at some videos for those first. All right, but this is just for some practice, so I'll kind of walk you through this. At any point, feel free to pause, and if you want to try to come up with your answer on your own first, that would be great, and then we can check it together. All right, so let's take a look at the first set of rules here before we get into the molecules themselves, just to kind of quickly recap where all this comes from. And so for this, you're going to determine the Lewis structure of the molecules. In this case, I've already built those. So we're going to be looking at the already existing Lewis structures. If you're doing this on your own, you may need to build that first. So again, you may need to go back and learn how to, if you haven't learned how to do Lewis structures, go back and check on that. Then, determine the number of regions or areas of electrons. Every textbook I look at calls it something different. However you want to define that, but regions of electron density around a particular atom. And here's the key. You want to make sure you're only doing this for one atom at a time. All right, so you're not applying hybridization to the entire molecule. All right, it's just to this carbon atom or to this oxygen atom or to this other nitrogen atom and so on. So we can assign hybridization at each one of those. So keep that in mind as you look at this as well. As you're trying to identify these regions, here are your possible region types. Some are more common than others. Any kind of bonding area is considered one region, whether that's a single bond where you see just a single line between two atoms, that counts as one region. All right, or if you see a double bond, so if you see the two lines between two atoms, that also just counts as one region, not two. A triple bond also is identified as just a single region then. All right, so that's one of the most common misconceptions when students are looking at this. They want to assign three regions as a triple bond. Doesn't work that way. Triple bond is still just one area or one region of electron density. The other common area is a lone pair of electrons. When you see those two dots on an atom, that also counts as one area. That takes up some space around that atom. And then this one's a little less common, a radical. If you just see a single dot by itself next to an atom, that's called a radical. That counts as one region as well. You're not going to see that as much in this course. When you go on to, say, organic chemistry, you'll see more radical systems there with those single dots. They're very reactive substances, and so that will factor into the hybridization that you have there as well. All right, and so then you assign the hybridization based on that particular geometry. Once you've identified how many areas or how many regions around that particular atom, it could be as few as 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. So that corresponds to the linear, all the way up through the octahedral. In fact, let's take a look at those areas here. And so this is looking again at the regions of electron density. You can have 2, 3, 4. We're going to look at 5 and 6 on the next slide here. And so if you just have two areas or two regions, again, this goes back to the VSEPR theory and assigning molecular shapes and geometric shapes there, that's a linear arrangement. So those two areas, whether they're bonded to another atom, whether they're lone pairs, whether it's that radical thing we just talked about, that's going to align in a linear fashion, 180 degrees from each other. The hybridization there, if there's two areas, you need two orbitals then. And so the hybridization is going to require two orbitals. You're always going to start with an S, and then you're going to add in one P orbital. So the hybridization there is going to be SP hybridization. All right, and again, there's that 180. If you have three total areas around a given atom, again, this is just one atom at a time, three total areas, whether it's a combination of single bonds, double bonds, triple bonds, whatever you've got going on there. If there's three total areas there, the shape is trigonal planar, like you learned earlier. And the hybridization there is going to require three areas. Start with an S, and you need two P orbitals then. So SP2 would be the hybridization there. Tetrahedral, four total areas. This is really common, especially in organic molecules, organic chemistry molecules. Tetrahedral is the arrangement there. SP3, you need a total of four four orbitals to make that up. So you need an S, and you're going to use all three of your P orbitals. So SP3 is the hybridization. Remember, however many orbitals you start with, that's how many hybridized orbitals you're going to get out of that. So here you're going to have two different SP hybridized orbitals. Here you'll have three different SP2 hybridized orbitals. And here you'll have four different SP3 hybridized orbitals. All right, arranged, oriented, again, in those geometries there. And so 120 for the trigonal planar, 109.5 approximately for that tetrahedral bond angle. All right. And so then let's look at the next couple of steps up then with 5 and 6 total areas of electrons. These are less common if you go into inorganic chemistry. We look at a lot of transition metals. This is also looking at the third period elements like sulfur and phosphorus and chlorine. Those elements are the only ones that can do this for good reason. To have 5 areas, then you're going to need 5 orbitals to put in there. An S orbital, all 3 P's. Now you're out of P orbitals, though, so the next available orbital would be a D orbital. So the hybridization with 5 total areas, 5 regions, is going to be SP3D hybridized. All right, an S, 3 different Ps, and 1 D orbital. Why does that only happen starting in the third period? Well, that's the first energy level where we have D orbitals. All right, we have a 3s, we have 3p, and there's 3d orbitals. We don't actually fill the 3d until we fill in the 4s. That's why they don't show up until the fourth row of the periodic table. But that third energy level, that's why there's d orbitals available for hybridization then. That's why we don't see that for elements like oxygen or nitrogen. They don't have d orbitals in that second energy level for their valence electrons. So that's what's going on there. Octahedral then, 6 total areas on that one. SP3D2. 6 total orbitals there, 1 S orbital, 3 different P orbitals, that gives us 4, and then you need 2 more, those are going to come from the D orbital set. So SP3D2 is the hybridization. That will give you 6 equivalent orbitals, all oriented in that octahedral arrangement. All right, with 8 faces, 6 things coming off of it though. Bond angles there are all 90 degrees. The trigonal bipyramidal is the other shape. That's what you get with 5. And that has 2 different orbital types, the axial and the equatorial. The axial positions are oriented 90 degrees to their nearest neighbors, and the equatorial positions are all oriented 120 degrees to their nearest neighbors that aren't the axial. They're 120 to the other equatorial positions. All right, so that was your hopefully really quick review of this. So let's take a look at this molecule, and not going to worry about naming it. I've also put in some little subscripts here just to help us keep track of all of similar or alike elements, like these 3 different, actually 4 different carbon atoms that I have in here. So I've just got them labeled 1, 2, 3, and 4. All right, those are just for labeling purposes. I did the same thing with the oxygen. So here's oxygen 1, here's oxygen 2, just so we can differentiate in terms of our labeling. Like I said earlier, that we can assign hybridization to every single one of these atoms, except for the hydrogens. The hydrogens don't need any hybridization because they're only forming a single one bond from that. And so it's just that 1s orbital that allows it to form that bond. That's what has to overlap. But all the other elements here are going to have some sort of hybridization. Even these terminal atoms, they've got lone pairs. Remember, those lone pairs also count as areas of electrons in that. So here's my list of all the elements in this. So let's go ahead and assign it. We'll start with carbon number 1 over here. How many total areas? So again, pause at any point. If you want to just go through this and assign it yourself, go for it. All right, and if not, so I'll stand out of the way here a little bit, or you can get me in some weird position and say, look at it, you like my shirt too? Detroitium. Thumbs up to the 313. Anyway, I don't know what that means. So carbon 1 here has 4 total areas. Single bond here, single bond, single bond, single, 4 single bonds, no lone pairs, no double bonds, nothing else there. 4 total areas. So with 4 total areas, you need 4 bonds. Start with an S, and then 1, 2, 3. That's how many P orbitals you've got there. So SP3 would be the hybridization for carbon number 1. All right, so SP3 for that one. Pretty much the same thing here for carbon number 2. It too has 4 single bonds coming off of it. Remember, just look at one atom at a time. Don't try to do, you know, don't count, all right, I've got a triple bond, single bond, double bond. Don't do that. One atom at a time. That's all you want to do there for this. So carbon number 2, 4 total areas there as well. The single bond, single bond, single bond, single bond, no lone pairs, no other bonds, all single bonded there. And so SP3 hybridization there as well for carbon number 2. How about for carbon number 3? This one now is a little bit different. This one only has a total of 3 areas. The double bond, remember, only counts as one area. And then the single bond here, single bond there. So 3 total areas then for this carbon number 3. So we just need 3 orbitals to make up the hybridized orbital set here. So again, start with an S, and then you need 2 P orbitals. So SP2 is the hybridization at carbon number 3. All right, simple as that. How about carbon number 4? You do that one? This was really easy. How many total areas are there? You got the triple bond, that's one area. You got the single bond here, that's the second area. That's it. No other bonds, no other lone pairs, nothing else on that. So just 2 areas, so you need an S orbital and a P orbital. So SP hybridization there. You don't usually put any numbers when there's just one of something. So SP hybridization for carbon number 4. What have I got next? Oxygen number 1. Here's oxygen number 1 over here. This is an alcohol group attached to this second carbon in this case. So how many total areas around that oxygen number 1 right there? Well, we've got a single bond here, another single bond here, a lone pair right here, and a lone pair over here. You've got to have the correct Lewis structure to be able to do these. So it's going to show those lone pairs for you. So 4 total areas, the 2 bonding areas and the 2 lone pairs. We don't care what kind of bonds they are or whether they're just lone pairs, 2 dots or a single dot. That each counts as one area there. So 4 total areas around the oxygen. So just like carbon number 1, just like carbon number 2, the oxygen here is going to be sp3 hybridized. Because we used 4 bonds to make that up, an S and 3 different Ps. And then it's like you put them all into a bowl, you mix them up, chop them up into even parts, and separate them that way. It's a very crude way of doing that. We actually can do it mathematically with those wave functions that describe each of those orbitals. So that's oxygen number 1. Oxygen number 2 down here. It's got a double bond, but that's not all. What else does it have? It also has a lone pair here and a second lone pair right here. So there are 3 total areas around that oxygen. So just like carbon number 3, the oxygen here, oxygen number 2, is also sp2 hybridized. You have a total of 3 orbitals, the S and the 2p orbitals there. So sp2 hybridization for oxygen number 2. What else? We can even do this nitrogen over here. And so there are 2 areas on that nitrogen, the triple bond on one side, the lone pair on the other. Each of those needs an orbital to reside in. And so for that, SP hybridization is what we have there. 2 total areas, an S orbital and a P orbital is what we mix together, divide them up equally, we get 2 equivalent SP hybridized orbitals then for that. So that's nitrogen. And finally, I threw in this chlorine atom over here as well. How many total areas are on the chlorine? Well, it's got the single bond to the carbon, so that's one area. We've got a lone pair here, a second lone pair, a third lone pair. So 4 total areas, the single bond plus the 3 lone pairs. Again, all that matters is the total number of areas. So 4 total areas, start with an S, and 1, 2, 3 different P orbitals. So sp3 hybridization for the chlorine. All right. And so that's how you assign hybridization. Figure out how many total areas, and then figure out how that's the same number of orbitals you need to build those equivalent hybridized orbitals for those. The other thing we'll do with this is figure out how many sigma and how many pi bonds there are in this. And so this is really easy as well. Once you've got the whole thing laid out, all we need to look at are the bonds in this case. And so every bond, whether it's a single bond, a double bond, or a triple bond, there's 1 sigma bond in each of those. So if we just count up all the bonds here, that's going to give us our sigma bonding total. So there's 1 here. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, just 1 there, 10, and 11 right there. So there are 11 sigma bonds. Remember, with sigma bonding, that's that direct overlap of orbitals. All right. And so there are 11 sigma bonds then in this structure. And then pi bonds, all you've got to look at are those multiple bonds. It's the next bonds, the second and third bonds that 2 atoms can make with each other. This is that sideways overlap, oftentimes done with p orbitals. You can also do this between p and d orbitals, not quite as common. But most of the time it's p orbitals that are both oriented, instead of straight on at each other, they're parallel to each other. But in different locations there. And so it's that sideways overlap above and below the main axis, above and below the sigma bond for that. So there's a pi bond right here. There's a sigma bond, first of all, between the carbon 3 and oxygen 2. The second bond in the double bond there is a pi bond. And then we see the same thing happening here between carbon number 4 and the nitrogen. Except instead of one pi bond, there's actually two. Again, you get the sigma bond, that's the first bond between them, and then the remaining bonds are pi bonds. All right, so there's one pi bond here, and there's actually two pi bonds between the carbon and the nitrogen. So that gives us a total of three pi bonds in this structure. All right, so that's how easy it is to figure out how many sigma and pi bonds. All right, every bond's a sigma bond. Right, has one of those in there. And then the double and triple bonds, double bonds then have one sigma, one pi, and the triple bonds have one sigma and two pi bonds. Easy as that, all right? That's all there is to it. Let's take a look at just a couple more examples here. Here's another Lewis electron dot structure. We're gonna look at the iodine atom. This is a specific kind of iodine ion here with two chlorines attached to it. It has a negative one charge. That's how we get an even number of electrons in this. So all we're going to look at here, actually, we can look at both the iodine and the chlorine, but the iodine's the fancy one here. So how many total areas around the iodine? Well, there's a single bond here, single bond over here, a lone pair here, a second lone pair here, and a third lone pair here. So there's a total of five areas around that iodine. So each of those areas needs a hybridized orbital. So if I need five hybridized orbitals, I've got to put in five unhybridized orbitals to make that. So we start with an S. Then we can use up to three. You're never going to have an sp4. You can't do it. There's not four p orbitals, all right? There's only three. So sp3 is as high as you can go there. What do we do when we run out of p orbitals? That's when we go to d orbitals. So if we need a total of five, you get an S, three different p's, and then my little pinky over here, that'll be a D orbital. So sp3D hybridization for that iodine. And then the chlorines on either side, they're both identical here. Each chlorine is sp3 hybridized. Each has four areas, the single bond and the three lone pairs. So sp3 hybridized there. All right, I got one more example for you. So this goes quick. Once you get the hang of it, it's pretty simple. Let's take a look at the chlorine in this chlorine pentafluoride molecule. And so how many areas around the chlorine? Well, we've got one, two, three, four, five single bonds to the chlorine atom, plus sandwiched right there is this one lone pair of electrons. So with the five bonds plus the one lone pair, that gives us six total areas. We need to put in six orbitals to get our six hybridized orbitals out. So that first orbital is going to be an S. Then we've got one, two, three different P orbitals. What are the remaining two going to be? The remaining two are going to be D orbitals. I didn't do that on purpose, did I? All right, so sp3d2 hybridization then. All right, that's what we have for the chlorine. Again, not super common, but that's what you'll see for any octahedral system. And that trigonal bipyramidal, that's always going to be an sp3d orbital. All right, how about the fluorines? Just like the chlorine example in the previous one there, each of the fluorines has four total areas around it, and so the fluorines are all sp3 hybridized. All right, so that should give you a pretty good idea of how to assign hybridization. Again, look at the total number of areas. That's how many orbitals you're going to take to make that number of hybridized orbitals. All right, orbitals in has to equal orbitals out. It's kind of the conservation of orbitals instead of conservation of mass idea. All right, so everything in has to get back out again. All right, so that's how you do some hybridization. So hopefully you got some good information from that. I'll see you in the next video.